is a really, really good player. So they're definitely a team that can impress. But it looks like we're in the game, and it looks like it is the knife round. Epsilon versus Publicir. I hope I said it correctly.
Let's try to say it as possible.
Yeah, we'll just say Publicir. And the winner of the knife round, for those who are new to Counter-Strike, will be able to decide which side of the map they will start off as. It is D'Inferno, and the better side, I think, is the CT side.
It's the more fun side. It's the more fun side. But yeah, I think definitely people will agree with you on that fact there. And let's see who manages to come out on top here. I'm expecting big things from Epsilon, just generally speaking. The thing is, though, you never know when you have a team that consists of Pyth and others.
Yeah.
You just never quite know. He seems to be in every single, just so many different teams. Pyth has been maybe one, you know, some of the most lineups ever.
Yeah,
he always makes it work, though.
Exactly. For a stand-in, he did so well with LGB. So, you know, he can definitely surprise us. And he's the main player that we know of with Publicir. And the other players, we're not 100%. We get half funds from the two sides, as we thought. Epsilon will be starting off as the T side, Publicir on the CT. And we do have two CZs with the CT side. Looks like it might be a second mid push here by the terrorists. You have one remaining on T ramp. Just think they still push in for a banana, which is what they're doing. Two CTs go to push for a banana. Very aggressive play here by the Swedish side. But Epsilon, ready in apartments for that bombsite A execute.
I love that really, really proactive play to find out maybe. And we are seeing Epsilon slowly, not really deterred by this pressure. And Publicir didn't lose a single man, nor did Epsilon in such an aggressive opening here. But slowly, Epsilon do creep up mid, and we're about to get contact here over a CT arch. It does seem to be that Epsilon are going to be making their move. They've got a minute left in the round, and Publicir are all over them.
Very nice smokes there by the T side. Kiyoshima getting a kill on Pith early on. Arguably the strongest player for Publicir, but the CTs return the favor as GMX and SF both go down. Kiyoshima with a second kill this round. It's 3-on-3. They still don't have full control of the bomb site. The bomb might be getting... No, the bomb isn't getting planted yet. Shox and Kiyoshima are the last men standing. We have three CTs trying to retake the bomb site. The bomb is now going to be planted by Shox. There's a nice little economic boost from the T side. Kiyoshima trying to keep the CTs at bay and doing quite a good job. He does a bit of damage on all three of them. There's not a lot of HP left. And Shox and Kiyoshima both at the same time getting the final kill. It's Kiyoshima against Punkus. And who will get the better of who? Kiyoshima has just slightly more HP, and he does finish off the job. Bomb planted, and the T's win the first round. 1-0 for the Frenchman.
That was an amazingly high-level pistol round from both teams. Oops, what are we seeing here? Let's get rid of that. So I find the overview. And, you know, we saw them, you know, moving aggressively up here in Publicir. Get that information. That's the best little arrow I ever threw in my life. And that allowed them to know what was happening on the map. But Epsilon didn't drop a single player. This aggression didn't lose them anything at all. They held solid to their strat. And that, like, that unwavering discipline there, that in the face of such aggression, is actually quite difficult because you get tempted to a panic reaction. But Publicir showing some good experience there, holding tight to their play.
Yeah, Publicir at the moment have gone for a full armor buy. With CZs, they do want to win this round. They want to stop the advantage of the French side, and by going for this early buy, and these guns are very, very, very dangerous, as we've seen before. We've seen a lot of the pro teams do absolutely ridiculous damage with these automatic pistols, and a lot of people crying nerf, nerf. But with a full armor CZ buy, it could go either way. Still, they're holding their positions. The T's will be going towards bombsite A. They don't have any idea of that yet. They do have one CT in apartments, which if the Epsilon side do not check relatively soon, they might be in for a bit of shock. He's going to peek at the wrong moment as GMX and SF together will get a kill. Puffran, though, takes down Kiyoshima from arch side and puts it back to a 4-on-4. CT's now all on arch side, trying to retake the bomb site. They have nothing to lose at the moment. Piff picking up that AK-47. It was dropped earlier on the round by Kiyoshima. Bomb is planted. The time factor is against them. And are they just going to go and try and save the armor in AK-47? Will they try and go for it? They don't have a lot of time left. It is a pretty much full save by the CT side. Except for one. And that's quit. He gets one kill. That hurts the economy of Epsilon slightly. But another round for the Frenchman in that anti-eco. Going for their benefit. 2-0.
So it was a really good save of that AK. You can really put a lot of work there. And I think it makes a lot of sense. They didn't have a lot of time to really do much, and they can keep the armor alive. And they're going to go for another eco anyway. So it made a lot of sense for them to just stick with the armor and the weapons there. And combined with the AK, looks like they want to turn that into an aggressive push here on Banana. Let's see how they manage to do with this, as it looks like Epsilon have a decent setup to try to deny this. There goes the action there from Kiyoshima. Not able to connect too much damage, but the grenades will force Publicir back off of that kind of offensive position on Banana. So Epsilon now, they have contained that threat. They are pushing that position while still maintaining presence on the rest of the map. And looks like Bonkus is a lone man here. Not any help to be found. No grenades from his teammates, nothing. And Publicir now to deal with an impending rush from Epsilon.
They've held them back so far. Not an eco round, that's not bad at all. They do know they're going towards Bonsai B. They have three CTs waiting for them, two in Bonsai, just in case they move Pith. Doing a great job getting the first kill. Will he get the second? He puts him on low HP, but Mister comes in to the rescue. Getting the first, won't get the second. Now it's back on to a 3-on-3, but three CZs against three AKs, or two AKs and a Galil. It's not too great. Pith actually picks up Pith's AK-47, but is it a rotation towards Bonsai E by the T side? Nobody's there to stop them. Pufran quickly rushing towards the site, seeing if he can at least stop the defuse. Maybe get them off guard.
Got to be careful with that CZ. Not so many bullets in there, but two men left. There's an AK on Quicks, and it seems to be that Quicks is just going to just chill over by the fountain here. Chill with the fishes. With the fish, even. And Pufran's going to see if he can find some exit frags. And probably suicide it in the end. But generally speaking, I think Publicir have been doing quite a good job. And it was a very marginal pistol round. It was a pistol round that could have gone either way, frankly. Both teams with exceptional performances there. And a nice little exit kill for Pufran. Maybe he can actually pick up that weapon. And both players of Epsilon are quite low as well. I don't know if there's anyone, no one visible. But another AK picked up. So pretty good situation for Publicir. They're not going to be playing with any AWPs, of course, but I'm interested to see what kind of setup that they go for. Are they going to show us more aggression on Banana, as is the metagame, as is and a very effective style to play this map as far as seeking information goes?
Yeah, we saw them on the eco stacked bomb site B, then A, then B, back to B, and it kind of worked out for them. They were able to slow them down slightly.
But, I love the smoke. Sorry to interrupt you there. I love this smoke because you can do it three ways. You can either play further back, you can play the middle smoke, which gives you position on the sandbags and car, or you can play the deep smoke on logs. That's kind of the middle road there, and that does give them really nice control without quite so much risk. The deep log smoke gives you, it pretty much gives you the exact picture of what's happening on the map, but there is quite a risk because if you have to make an aggressive push with nades, you're going to have contact, and if you go down, you can just lose the round outright. So I love the middle of the road play there from Publicir.
Yeah, and Banana Control has really been the hallmark of this map lately. And losing Banana Control, or losing control of that part of the map, does not bode well for either side. As we do have two terrorists slowly sneaking towards Bombsite B. Three now. One making a lot of noise in Bombsite A, perhaps trying to get the attention of the CTs towards that direction.
There's Pop Flash. And Bonkus, can he deliver with the Pop Flash? No, he can't get the frags. He only gets one. Can Quick save it though.
So a great little bit of team play there in the bomb site with that pop flash, but Bonkus was not able to deliver and get that double kill. He was able to take one down, but it's a 3-on-2 bomb down, bomb planted, sorry. And with the bomb site control to the French side, it's now up to Pith and Samster to retake control. They're both coming in from graveyard now. The terrorists are all over the map. It's very tough for them. They're all hiding, not peeking. I do know they're both coming from that direction. They get the first kill, they will get the second. It's all up to Mistu now, and he gets a double kill, defending that bombsite relatively well indeed. And that's something we did not expect. The unexperienced player rising up to the occasion there, and getting the round for the Frenchman. It's 4-0 for Epsilon.
They're taken to 21 health on the last man. Epsilon, they are not winning any of these rounds just without losses, severe losses. Every single round they're taking damage, and you know, we can see that their money is not actually, considering they've won 4 rounds in a row, that good. And we're seeing, you know, an opening frag coming out from Mistu, and this is going to really hurt the control on Banana. This is going to allow them that option, but they're probably going to sit on this for a while. They're probably going to let Publicir stew in their own panic and perhaps, you know, misinformation, because they have to make calls. You know, what are Epsilon doing? That is the question for them. Ponkus, though, sitting with that AWP, he will have some support there, but that is a 2-2 split on either side. A is definitely the favorable one to go for in that situation, but what is Epsilon going to choose? Will the mind games hurt them, or will it give them the edge?
Well, Ponkus did a good job picking up that AWP that was dropped by Perfran early on in the round and made it a less damaging loss. But we do have 2 shotguns there in apartments, and it's going to be very painful as Pith will get the kill on Shox, arguably the best player for the French side. And this is a very big mistake here by Team Epsilon, pushing into apartments towards a shotgun. Not very good. Goodness me, actually, every shot missed from that I think they were just far away. They weren't in range. And now they're pushing in. They do know exactly where they are. Quicks trying to stop them from pushing through apartments into the bombsite. SF will be able to drop down and get that kill. Mistu with one as well. Ponkus now, the final man with an AWP. Is he going to try and go for that round? Or perhaps try and save that AWP? I guess he is. He was thinking about it then. Perhaps dissuaded by his teammates. Ponkus will be pulling back.
Ponkus, I got this, guys. I got this. 1-on-3, I got an AWP. Retake, no problem. But he doesn't even have a kit. He doesn't even have a kit. That's how confident he was. But no. Of course,
they told him to hide back.
Definitely.
Ponkus, don't lose that AWP, Ponkus. We need the AWP, Ponkus.
Save the beautiful skin. Beautiful Asimov. It's worth a lot. But yeah, and again, another, you know, fairly close affair. It was quite funny over in apartments. You know, we saw that funny situation where there was basically terrorists all filling the screen, and the mag still missed.
Yeah, it missed every single shot.
It's crazy.
Now we know the distance where it's accurate and inaccurate, and it's basically apartment hallway, which is like 1 meter. So, I mean, if he had perhaps waited, let them go through, or perhaps hopped out just a bit later, it might have been a bit more damaging.
Definitely.
Anyway, we're going to thank all the viewers that we have at the moment. It's all 6,500 of you. It's a pleasure casting for you with DDK, and I hope you're enjoying the match and that you'll stick with us for the rest of the games. Nice nade, but SF denying the kill for Quicks as he gets the first and the second. A very aggressive play here by SF, controlling the bombsite. Will he get the third? Sadly not. Kiyoshima will finish off the job though. Now it's 2-on-4, and that was a very, very aggressive push by SF, and SF really showing how good of an entry fragger he is indeed.
That was just all pace. That was just, they completely outpaced Publicir there. That was just, Shox just ran through, SF just ran through apartments. It's not often that you see that. You can see he's holding the nade, he's gonna throw the nade, you know, he throws a nade, the guy's gonna go, oh no, a nade, I'm gonna fall back. Yeah. He just ran through the nade and just gunned him down. And that was all she wrote. And already on top of quad before he can even make the call to his teammates about what's happening. I love that, because that just shows a great understanding of the game to do stuff like that. It looks a bit like something you see on matchmaking, you know, just running at people. But this is high-level CS, and sometimes that is the right move.
It looks like Mistu is actually top fragging for his team. 6 kills and 2 deaths, not bad whatsoever for the newcomer. On the other hand, probably clear, not doing as well. We have a standard 2-3 split here. Pretty fast banana push there by the terrorists. I wonder if they're going to go all in. It's 2 CTs coming towards them. And Auto Director is going to make us miss the action as GMX will get a double kill. They do have control of the bombsite. They're going to try and retake. Shox will be waiting for them. But Shox unable to rise for the occasion. Team Epsilon will be able to plant the bomb in the bombsite if they're capable. Yep, there you go. Took a bit longer than usual. But now it's up to the CT side to retake the bombsite. It's going to be relatively tough for them. Very good job there by GMX to get the 2 entry frags into the bombsite.
So here we just have a situation where, okay, 2 rifles save, Samser and Pyth. Going to save it. Puffran, get some exit kills. Get yourself a gun. Join the club of guys saving their guns, because right now you don't have them. There he has. He has one now, but I don't know if he can save this. He does have an onslaught of players rushing towards him, almost taking down another one, which would have been a big help to the economic battle that they're facing right now. I mean, Publicir, they're going to have a lot of money just because of the consecutive money bonus or round loss bonus. But we can see that Epsilon, they are building the bank. They are building the bank pretty severely right now. Almost 16k on Misty. That is just crazy.
Misty's been doing so well. 7 kills and 2 deaths. Shocks, the player, the star player that we expect to be top fragging is not. And the novice that we do not expect to top frag is. And perhaps it's because the rest of the team are not taking the game as seriously as Mistu. On the other hand, it might be just Mistu really reaching his potential.
I don't know how to use these graphs here. I'm just experimenting because we're in a pause. So yeah. Like, let's just go for it.
Headshot percentage.
Everyone loves these.
But what does it mean when it changes? Does it mean it's been 100 since then?
It is unclear to me, sir. It is frankly unclear to me. These lines, they look pretty though.
They look nice.
They sure look good.
I like it. I like looking at it. I'm sure everybody likes watching these lines as well.
Yeah, this is definitely something. You can see the buyers here, like the subsequent ecos or pistol loss. And this was where they bought pistol armor, then the saves, and then buy, and then just getting crushed and crushed and crushed, more or less. Mm-hmm. But the thing is that the economy is being fairly stable all the way for Epsilon, despite some of the losses. And that's actually... Talking about state of mind for your team when you're playing, there is always that effect. Let's say if you're playing with like, okay, if we lose this round, we have to eco. You know, if you're always playing within an inch of an eco, there, you know, with that margin of error being so small, that does have a slight effect. They're playing with such comfort right now.
Indeed. They're playing nice and comfortable. Publicir have done an okay job to keep their economy relatively stable. For losing 7 rounds in a row, they've been able to cause some damage. And here we do have a banana push by the T side. Quicks will get a kill, so will Ponkus, and that's going to stop it right on its tracks. But will they continue to push towards bombsite B? It looks like the CTs are thinking that perhaps it is a rotation towards bombsite A, and it doesn't look like that is what is happening. Perhaps the Ts are just trying to spread out and cause confusion. In fact, just waiting for the opportune moment, as the CT who's rotating towards bombsite A, Pith, is now going towards bombsite B, or keeping himself in the middle. And it looks like it's going to be a push into bombsite A here from the apartments and mid at the same time. It's up to Samster. Will he be able to hold him off? Flash is going to stake him for a second. They know exactly where he is. They throw that Molotov right on top of his head.
Really important Molotov there to remove that angle onto quad. Samster's a key player to stay alive for their defense to be successful, and in they go. Samster unable to have an impact just yet. He just gets taken down by GMX without any answer, no response whatsoever. But Epsilon are having a lot of troubles here. It is a 2-on-2. They will get the bomb down. Quips and Pipe do remain for the retake. Can they coordinate themselves? Can they bring this about to be the first round here for Publicir against Epsilon, who are just mounting this huge lead. Pyth is there with the first one, gets the second frag as well, and that will be the first round going to Publicir. Finally, they get themselves on the board, and it really couldn't have come sooner.
Excellent retake there by the two CTs. It was a 2-on-2 situation. They did have more HP than the terrorist counterparts, but the first round for the CT side, and perhaps it's good news for them. 7-1, best case scenario, they win the next 7 rounds, make it 8-7. On this CT-sided map, but it will do a bit for their confidence so that they finally at least were able to get around against the T-side. But what do you think went wrong exactly?
It was just, I think, a battle of execution. I think Publicir had a very, very good line of defense. They just played a good standard game, and I think they out-executed Epsilon overall there. I don't think it was much more than that. But the biggest deal for Publicir right now is the fact that if they want to bring this back to a scoreline where on the T-side they feel, all right, we don't feel pressured, we feel comfortable with this, they cannot afford to lose any rounds in the next few rounds, because if we look at their bank, it's nothing. They're forced to an eco, more or less, or a forced buy with Pyth dropping some stuff. That's what they're forced to. And then they then lose that situation. Before you know it, it's you know, maybe 11-4, 10-5, something like that. So there's a lot of pressure on Publicir right now, as they are losing apartments. Or are they? Samson has something to say about that.
I was just about to say that Epsilon have such incredible map awareness in the past few rounds, but for some reason, SF didn't bother to check the apartments, and that was a good push, well-timed by, I do believe it was Ponkus. GMX will get that entry frag on Pufran into the bombsite, and a quick rotation towards bombsite B is going to put the CTs in a relatively bad and uncomfortable situation, unless Ponkus is able to rotate in time. Quicks will slow them down with that smoke and flash, and that's a good job by him. It's 4-on-4. The round could go either way. We do have 1T on our side. He's going to be coming in all the way behind enemy lines, and this is going to be pretty bad for the CT side. If they do not see shocks coming up, he's running with his knife at the moment. If he pulls out his AK-47, he's going to shut down the CT defense. He looks to his left, and dear lord, Punkus will go down. Quicks will be able to get a kill, and he wasn't there in time. At least he puts it on a 2-on-2 situation. It could have been a lot worse if he hadn't been behind enemy lines. Now Pith is coming in. He knows somebody's here. Shocks against Pith at the graveyard. Who will get the better of who? Pith knows he's there, but Shocks will get the headshot. And now it's 1-on-1. Samster against GMX. This is a very important round for Public Clear. Will they be able to win it? It's GMX, the in-game leader, but it's Epsilon, and he's in the perfect position. Samster has no idea he's there, and he'll be able to pick up the round for Epsilon. 8-1 for the French side, and I think right there they crushed any chances of them getting a good amount of rounds this half.
Yeah, this is looking increasingly desperate here for Public Clear now. They're going to have to try to find some way to save this. They're going to go for another eco, but after this, they are going to be in for a hell of a ride. And we're seeing the CTs coming out. How do they decide to play this? We're going to see a quick pressure, or perhaps not. Actually, they're going to go for the old play here, where maybe they get a couple of frags. Oh no, they're going to go with a flash and go in. I thought they're going to bait, do a lot of bait play, but it looks like they're going to go aggressive with three men in a banana, but just the head's just getting popped off by Epsilon. No hope for them at all. Dream in the pistol just completely shut down.
Yeah, and they were hoping to surprise Team Epsilon, but the Frenchmen were ready for that. I think they've studied their opponents well, or they've been pretty focused during the game, and that's something that Public Clear have been doing throughout the game. They've been going for those aggressive pushes, they've been going for the pop flash with one man behind the sandbag. It's worked for them a bit, it's got them a few kills, but now that Team Epsilon have caught the game, it's not really going to work anymore. Epsilon waiting back in the beginning of banana until they wait for that flash to be thrown and then pushed after that, and that was a very smart play there by the Frenchman.
And Quicksran and Ponkers actually switched roles here because they don't have enough smokes. They don't have enough nades even. And we're seeing a lot of action over the other side of the map here. Puffran shut down over at quad. What can they make happen here? Quicks is there to respond through outside, and it all just falls. It's great cleanup from Pyth there right at the end. But they haven't got the nades, and this is a big issue for them. That's a great, great pickup of that round, because things can get so bad for the CT side. Once the economy starts just going down the toilet and you're struggling for nades, and if the T side realizes that, they can use that against you. They can have these plays that like really are delayed, prolonged attacks that weather all your nades, like all your reserves are gone. And again, we're seeing an aggression right down banana here. Quick separated from his teammate, and Ponkus not going to really experience much love there from the French side.
Well, an aggressive push on your own is a pretty tough thing to do, as Quicks tries to keep it up, keep control of banana. They do know they're not going to be going towards bomb site B, at least. That's the information they have for now. But it is the quiet or the silence before the storm, as Epsilon are getting ready for aggressive push there by Samster. It's going to be a mistake for the CT side as he gets taken down by SF. Pith going back to rotate and help his teammate in bomb site B. There's only one person in A at the moment. That's Puffran.
And there is, let's see, five smokes still for Epsilon. Epsilon are still fully loaded on nades. They have everything. And looking at publicly, again, nades are very important on the CT side. They have nothing. They've got three flashes, a Molotov, and an HE. Now, they're going to get lucky here because Epsilon are going to go to the site that they are effectively kind of stacked towards with the two men on that beacon site. But this is going to have to be an immense performance here from the Swedes. Can they pull it off here? Pyth spamming through that smoke, not getting lucky, getting that return on the spam through as well. Going to go through? Is he going to wait for his teammate? He really needs to wait for Puffran to come and aid him. Puffran does have a couple flashes. He can cross over to the aid of Pyth, but this is going to be so difficult.
They're able to do a bit of damage towards the French side. They don't have a lot of HP on a few of their players, Shocks and Kiyoshima. But now I think the best chance for the CTs is to go back for a save and maybe get one or two exit frags. Pyth will be able to take down GMX, who's trying to deny them the save. And are the T's going to go for the bait, or are they just going to try and get away from the bomb explosion radius, because they don't have a lot of HP on them. They do get to save one M4 as Kiyoshima one-shot headshots Pyth. But one M4 at least is the At least it's better than nothing. That's all you can say.
That's all you can say, isn't
it? Yeah, it's better than
it's
nothing.
It's that bad.
Yeah, they're in a bit of trouble right now. 10-2 with 3 more rounds left in this half. The CTs don't look like they're in a great position on this relatively CT-sided map against Epsilon. 10-2 behind. It's very improbable you'll be able to catch up. But we have seen miracles before, and perhaps we'll see a miracle today as a double nade will drop down. Oh, Kiyoshima God. Will get the kill on Punkus, and that must have exploded right on top of his head to do more than 80 damage. Punkus, the unlucky victim of that nade. The Shocks will get a solid spray down on Samsta. 3 against 5 already. And the CTs have to be careful.
I'm almost cringing at this point for Publicir. Things are looking so, so grim. I mean, a 10-5 scoreline really is the least that they could have wanted. And at this point, they're playing with 1 rifle, 2 auto pistols, and Epsilon are breathing down their neck, and that will be Puffran taken down as well, which is Quicks and Pyfe remaining. And that was their M4. That was their last rifling player. And now Publicir's Pyfe and, or Pith, and Quicks are isolated now. They don't have anything. And we can see Quicks is just going to be going here for some frags that they've already spotted. Maybe they can see his gun through the door there. I'm not quite sure.
Not too sure, but all I know is we can't see his gun for some reason. Quicks.
Having some weird bug.
Yeah, it's a bug with Quicks on. And there you go, Kiyoshima will get the final kill. The CT is getting completely demolished. 2 rounds where they've barely lost any players. And I think rather than, usually on a map like the Inferno, especially when the CT side's ahead, we see a lot of comebacks. Even when the T side's ahead, a lot of comebacks halfway through the game. After one of the teams gets 6-7 rounds, the other side suddenly starts to play accordingly to the playstyle of the other side, and they're able to get one, you know, 3-4 rounds and make it a more equal story. But on this, we actually see Epsilon go on stronger and stronger as we go into the game, and they look better and better throughout the game. Mistu has not been fragging as he was earlier on, but still, the rest of the team, GMX and Kiyoshima, have been getting a few double kills and whatnot. So, for Publicir, it just looks worse and worse. We do have 3 Clarions, or Famases, as people call them.
Go back to 1.6, man. Oh my god.
Wait, yeah. The thing is, they're very similar guns, they're just slightly different.
The burst doesn't work.
Yeah, I guess.
Burst sucks, man. But it looks like Epsilon are moving through to mid, and they have done this play repeatedly. It's been very effective. Look at this. They're just going to go for the smoke. Such a brave play coming in from the French players, but they're good
big
for
mistake.
Pyfe behind Ooh. The lines, taking them all down. He gets a third as well. Pyfe on Ooh. Fire to save the round. Missed 2 falls.
He
didn't know what happened. And what a round there. Publicir actually punishing Epsilon for what was a very ballsy play.
Wow. Pith waiting for the opportune moment. We saw him get flashed by Shocks. He simply looked away. He didn't spray through and give away his position. He actually waited for the T's to run through. Shocks was taken down by one of the opposite players. I think it was Puffran, who's at Pit. And then Pith comes out, gets the double kill, and gets the third to make it a triple kill, and he actually won the round for Publicir. And that's the kind of stuff we want to see from the Swedes. We want to see them making sure that they get the mistakes that Epsilon makes and win rounds out of it. And that was a big mistake, not checking to the left, not checking library. But GMX,
he's been on point. He's been really, really, really solid so far. I mean, he's always getting these entry frags. He's getting these long range picks on mid. He's been playing fantastically so far. Some of the rounds they've won, just because GMX walks in to mid, looks to Arch, looks to Quad, there's a guy, sprays him down, and it just wins those fights, and that just gets them that entry. And
he breaks the fable of if a player's an in-game leader, he can't get any kills, he can't get any frags. And he kind of breaks that that stereotype, I guess.
I've seen quite a few of these top teams start to do that as well. Happy is a guy like that as well these days, being a bit of a beast.
Yeah, you're right, actually. But that was very nice by GMX, who didn't really show his face. He just wanted to kind of lure Puffran into firing those shots. Samsa trying to see if he can get SF by surprise, but you're not going to get Super Fighter out of on surprise, but Puffran will get the headshot on him. GMX will get his second kill of the round. And they do have control of the bomb site. It's 4-on-2. Quicks and Punkus, the last man standing. Punkus actually getting a kill, making a 3-on-2. And very interesting position here by the T side.
Whoa.
In pretty much exactly the same time, Shox and GMX will get a kill each and make it 12-3. Publicir going into the second half with only three rounds. It's going to be a very, very tough half for them.
Definitely. And the loser of this is going to play again on this stream. We're going to have, of course, loads of this, which so far looks like, you know, Publicir, they're not looking in a great spot. Just going to say, not going to say they lost, but they don't look like they're in a great spot. And so if they lose this, they're likely to play Berserk, because I haven't seen the results from NIP Berserk and how that's going, but I'm going to presume that NIP are probably safe there.
Yeah, but I do know that the NIP match was delayed a lot more than this match due to the power breakdown, which caused the delay, and pretty much a whole switch died, and the tech guys have been working hard to fix the internet over at DreamHack. So good luck to them. Hopefully there won't be any issues. Oh my goodness, Kiyoshima. A very nice headshot on Quicks. He could barely see his head. GMX pushing through. We'll get the second kill of the round. Third, actually. And it's only up to Poffran and Stamster. And as I said that, it's now up to Stamster, the last man standing. And this looks like a much stronger pistol round than the first one. And as I mentioned earlier, Epsilon are just playing better and better. And especially on a stronger side now, on the CT side, you can definitely see the difference between the two.
The concepts that play in this round and where things went really well for Epsilon is the fact that the CT pistols kind of suck when it against the Glocks when it comes to close range, even the mid-range battles. They can kind of suck because the Glocks, you know, you can run and gun and they're really effective. But at the longer ranges, the Glocks perform a lot worse. PD-1000 and the USPs did really, really well. And they were able to get two frags already from those ranges at the start of the round. So that really shut down the aggression before it could even get started. So Epsilon on top of things and Shox with a pick down mid on the anti-eco, you know, starting things off well here. But really well played from Epsilon there.
I think Epsilon, they've begun to figure out exactly how Publicir play. They're much more confident. They're pretty much aiming at exactly the right positions and at the right time. And they've pretty much figured out almost 100% what they're going to do on almost every single round. But Publicir now went for a bombsite A, little push, but rotated towards bombsite B. There are two CTs waiting for them. Don't need to rotate. Nice headshot there on Shox to put him on 9 HP. But the real push was towards bombsite B. SF not doing a great job. He'll back away, stay alive to get at least a kill. Kiyoshima will hop out for support and get the first. And goodness me, not bad there by Quicks as he will get the kill, but not control of the bombsite as the CTs have done a very, very quick rotation towards it. Now Quicks is in a bit of a tough position, pretty much covered from every single possible side. And he won't be able to finish the round with any kills. 14-3 is very close towards Epsilon's victory. They only have two more rounds to win. And we can see the scores. 17 for GMX. As I said, he has been rising up to the occasion in the second half of the game, getting quite a lot of kills and quite a lot of entry frags for an in-game leader.
Yeah, it's really been going fantastic for them. After the game, because of course, Epsilon, they were really winning this game and gave themselves the best chance to win this on their great T half. And so after this game, I want to show a few things as the Zico closes out about the way that they managed to effectively do that and the solutions that they found quite quickly into the match and something that Publicir were not able to give an answer for, because that's what actually happened in large part. And we see the 15th round there for Epsilon going down and with ease as they are playing against just, you know, some CZs. They didn't even lose a single man. So here we go into what could be the last round between these two teams here.
The T side for the Swedes has been relatively lackluster so far. They haven't provided anything fresh, anything dynamic, but they have been three pistol rounds as well. So there's not much we can expect. But it looks like it's a very aggressive push here. I think a few too many flashes have been thrown down mid. There's nobody there to receive them. Shox on truck side will get a bit of the afterflash there. And it's a quick push into outside. Are they going to push towards bombside B? There are three CTs there. That would be a huge mistake by them. They do have control of library right now. And I think they have control of the bombside. Yeah, Autodirector's loving the apartment sky, but it looks like the terrorists have control of the bombsite. CTs have given it to them. Now it's time for them to retake. And this is not bad whatsoever by Publicir, who somehow have been able to go in undefended
And this has got a big job in his hands. At the very least, publicly are quite low, and they're all in the bomb site itself. This is bodes very well for Epsilon. They're cleaning up house easy, and well, four of them still left alive. And that was really strange, wasn't it? I mean,
the thing is, when you go into a bomb site like bomb site A, you do not want to let, you don't want to have CT sitting in pit. You don't want to have CTs in library able to just hop out and retake the bomb site straight away. You have to try and clean up before planting the bomb, especially when you're on the final round and especially if you're on the buy round. But 16-3.
Definitely. And if we could go back to the, maybe we can go back to the game in a bit and I can show some stuff before the next game. Maybe we can talk a bit about some of the ways that they were getting into that really strong T half. And just to briefly explain what I saw, at least, is we didn't really see the successes at B. They didn't really need to have successes at B, because what they found was a lot of the time, you know, okay, they do take the initial map control, which is quite standard. And we were seeing Publicir doing very nice plays to deter them from, you know, pushing up Banana fully in some rounds. But generally speaking, Banana didn't really care much about it, apart from just basic control. So what was really happening was they were getting a lot of these pushes through apartments and through mid. And the way it works with the CT defense is often, of course, you have like a three-man setup usually. And what happens is you have the very outside setup. So let's say, you know, across outside boiler, you know, you've got the guy at CT Arch, you know, quad, and then apartments as well. They're all like in a line. So they can help each other, they can nade for each other, they can really help to react as a team against any aggressions from the terrorists. But what happened was, with the nades and with the pushes, they were getting pushed back and back and back straight into the site. And the terrorists didn't even use that many nades to do that. So they would always have a lot of nades left. And then you're sat and imagine you're publicly. You have nowhere to turn, backs against the wall, no position to fall back to, no help really, and all the nades are coming in. And we saw that the French side were amazing at hitting the shots. Like GMX was so consistent on taking out guys on the mid entries every time.
Yeah, especially in the second half of the game. Once they started to get warmed up, they always had their crosser in the right position, especially with the pre-fire. And the crosser was always there in the right spot. And they did a great job, especially on the CT side. They pretty much missed zero shots in the second half.
Definitely. So I guess what this means is, because if the other game was delayed, that means, again, let's presume that NIP win. So, you know, I mean, that's surely is a safe bet against Berserk. Let's assume that happens. Then what we'll be seeing next is, on this stream at least, is Berserk versus the Swedes and Publicir. And hopefully the Swedes get a better showing, because I feel like they didn't really get to show us their game. I feel like that's what happened there.
At the moment, NIP has paused the game. GTR got VAC'd.
He got VAC banned or something. What? Gerai's been cheating. That's how he won all those awards. Been cheating at LAN.
For 10 years, he's been cheating. But it's 5-5, actually, at the moment, between the two sides.
Wow,
if
nice.
If I'm not incorrect. So that's a relatively close game between NIP and Berserk, former team alternate. So, in fact, you never know. It could be NIP versus Publicir. And then it would be a domestic matchup, two Swedes. And then you never know. NIP might just be, you know, you could have a surprise game and Publicir could win against NIP. So, but most likely, NIP will probably win back that game against Berserk, and we'll have a Berserk versus Publicir next on this channel. However, back to the game, as we were mentioning before. With Epsilon, the only thing that really Publicir could have done on the T side, especially with barely any rounds to them, is to try and place better flashes and better smokes. I mean, one of the things that we kind of noticed during the game is that on the T side, you know, for the few rounds they played on the T side, they weren't throwing very effective flashes and very effective smokes. And they weren't playing based on where Epsilon were holding their positions. And the positions Epsilon were holding were very, very deep. They weren't kind of forward playing as Publicir were during their half. So for that reason, during the last round, even though they were able to take control of the bomb site, they didn't take any of the CTs out. And they were pretty much all forced to kind of herd inside the bomb site, which is a pretty bad position to be in when you're surrounded by CTs who can come in from any angle and can come in with flashes and smokes. All they have to do is just throw loads of flashes into the bomb site and then just go in and clear up the job. So for that reason, I think they could have perhaps, you know, played a bit more intelligently, taking their time, threw in some flashes, got those early picks, and then played according to that. But at the same time, you only having three rounds on the CT side, it's very, very difficult to come back from that.
And I mean, like losing the pistol and everything, it was just It just, so, I mean, they're so close. The start of the match was like so close.
Very close.
If you just look at the very first round of the match, especially on a map like Inferno, I mean, if they were able to win that one, which was like so close, it could have been completely different. It really could have been
a different story. Yep.
Because it's so important to get those rounds rolling early on as a CT side. Really important.
I mean, but, the thing is, overall, Epsilon, they out-aimed them, they out-stratted them. They outplayed them in general, and it was just they're on a different level.
There's a couple of cool things to talk about as well. One thing that you mentioned, I think you used the word herding. I think that's actually a very, very good word to use, especially on Inferno, because we were talking about banana control briefly earlier, and the whole point again is actually like if you do place the deep smoke, you are essentially herding your opponents. And what this is okay, you're all the way down banana. And maybe later with a map I can draw and show you guys. But you're all the way down bananas. So where can they go? They've got mid and apartments. So if you've had some relatively forward guys with some flashes and stuff to aid them, you know, getting a bit of peak information and stuff like that, then it's great. You have a situation where you know what's happening, and they can't go banana because it's a choke point. It's smoked to hell. Yep. If they go up there, they're gonna die. So they are left with only a few options, and you know their options.
Yeah, exactly. And you know exactly what they're gonna do, and that's what map control is. But we've just heard that the 10th round is gonna be replayed, so it's 5-4 for NiP, it's gonna start again. So they've lost that draw that they had. I wonder what's gonna happen to that game. Yeah. Anyway.
So one last thing, because I imagine everyone's going to want to jump onto the stream to watch that game as it's going on, is the other really cool thing I saw from Epsilon, which is it might have just been because they're like, man, we're the shit. We're awesome, you know. Yeah. Maybe that's what it was.
Yeah.
But they had a lot of these very, very, very brute force aggressive plays mixed
very
in
confident.
Where it almost the no-nade style, like, I'm going in.
Yeah,
like, no-nades, nothing. We're not going to announce our presence. We don't need the flash. We're going to take the one-on-ones and rush you down. Those kinds of plays you don't see very, very often on the top level, but mixing those in is very dangerous. And I loved how they did it in rounds where they were quite safe. It's like, this round, you know, we have a buffer of rounds. We have got a good economy. We can take a risk.
Yeah, and it's all to do with the confidence. It's the confidence factor. Once a team has the confidence to play like that, they do know that their opponents are a bit jittery or a bit off balance and are unable to hold the angles properly. And if they were able to hold the angles properly, that kind of play is absolutely disastrous, just running in without flashes and smokes. So they knew that the CT side were disorganized and they weren't holding the right angles, and so they were able to play like that. And in those rounds, when you can play like that, it's absolutely disastrous for the CTs. So again, Epsilon, once they got those first few rounds, they got that confidence. They're out-aiming their opponents. They're out-playing them. On the T side, they're winning rounds constantly on Inferno, which simply means they're either out-aiming them or completely using strategy. And the thing is, one thing we noticed in the game as well, I mean, other than when they were on the CT, I loved, you mentioned it as well, the herding, it was a conscious decision by the CTs. It wasn't like they were in their positions, they had no idea the terrorists were coming in, and they just hid there, and they were like, oh, look, we have terrorists and bombs. It was more like, guys, let them come in, let them waste their flashes and smokes, hold your positions, and then after they plant the bomb or after they get into that position, we'll push in at the same time.
Yes, yeah.
And that kind of play is, it's absolutely beautiful.
It's
wonderful to watch. And hopefully that's what happened. We can't really go into their brains, but it looked like that.
No, I think you're completely right. And it's not too outside of the how teams are approaching the game in many senses. For example, I think the best illustration of, let's say, a very set strategy where this is what people try to attempt to do in the top level is on Mirage pistol rounds for CT side. Because it used to be the case where it's like you'd have the standard setup, and eventually people worked out. It's like, guys, actually, if they just do hammer B hard somehow, it's really hard to retake B. We need a strong defense there to start the round. We can kind of have like a defensive line like at CD spawn, all the way back at jungle. If they rush into A, fine, we'll play the retake. We'll just retake. Big open site, it's fine. We'll play the retake. And like you said, the coordinated attack onto the bomb site, which is not very easy to hold, that's what they're going for. And it looked a little bit baffling at first. We were like watching Mistu, like looking like opposite away from the site.
Yeah.
Like all the CTs like just cowering in the bomb
exactly,
site.
But exactly.
But that was such a terrible position in that site as well.
Yeah, yeah. It's very difficult. It's very difficult. And that's something publicly they should have done as well. They shouldn't have herded everybody into the bomb site and kept people back in their different positions, perhaps kept somebody in apartment, kept mid control just in case they get rotated from behind, and perhaps had somebody on arch side just in case they push in from archway and library. And it would have been a different story.
it would have been a very different story. But I think they were just shocked that they were able to take control of the bombsite so quickly. And so they just pushed in anyway.
It's such a panic situation, isn't it? It's just like, you don't know where to look, like who to shoot, like where's the bomb going down, like what positions can we take post-plant? You don't know what the hell's going on.
And I think at that kind of situation, you're expecting to lose the game. You don't really expect to come back 15-3 to get a draw, 15-15. You need a miracle for that, especially against a pretty solid side. And Epsilon, our former Clan Mystic, are looking to be a very, very solid side. And we can definitely see some good stuff. And the main reason I say this, because in that game, you did not see Shox carrying. You did not see one player. You saw all of them playing very well. You saw GMX.
So GMX, mad fragging, yeah.
Yeah, mad fragging. You saw Mistu doing a great job at the beginning of the game. So, it was an absolute pleasure to see them. But right now, we're going to go for a quick break, and we'll be back right after.
But before we go for a break, use this time. If there's any other delays, check out the Facebook platform. Check out what's happening on that platform. We had the DreamHack qualifiers there as well. And of course, if you guys are also fans of the Spring League, the Faceit Spring League, you can go to the Steam Workshop as well, find those Faceit skins and vote them in. And we, you know, if they make it into the cases, we get more leagues like the Spring League, which
yeah,
I think everyone loves.
Yeah, we get some awesome
loved.
Leagues. Yeah, exactly. And one thing I'd like to say you reminded me of was tweet us. Tweet us who you think is going to be number one in this group, number two. And who's probably going to win the Nip versus Berserk game? I'd love to.
And wait, also, you have to tweet. you got to vote for who is the more handsome stream. Is it me and Avela, or
it depends if you like chocolate milkshaker. Oh, you mean the other stream?
Yeah.
Oh, dude, there's no voting. I thought it was between us.
Yeah, we have to
like,
stick together, man. We're
yeah,
the
I was there. I was like,
come on,
he's trying to betray me. If you think our stream is more handsome, tell us. If you think the stream is better, tell us as well. Because I think that's a bit more important than handsomeness.
Getting some competition going. Yeah. All right, guys.
All right, we'll see you guys very, very soon.